attack on Wind Chaser. Went ahead and rented this beast. It's big kitty, and just gonna hop in. I think Jake was doing this. I think he actually finished this field, but I had to reset it just because the depth node in the middle wasn't quite right. So this is the John Deere 2623, 50-foot discs, and we broadcasted some NPK and lime over our alfalfa field, and now we're just doing disking it in. Same with some of our bigger fields, like 37. You can see it's a little bit darker back there. And 19, those are all finished. So we just rented this for the day, so we're trying to knock out a lot of our disking, basically our cultivation, and then we're gonna do the other fields with our 2720, just to get a little bit more nutrients into the soil. So what does he have his GPS set at here? We're at 15.6 meters. We're covering per pass at 12 miles an hour. So maybe someone could figure out the math on how many acres we're covering per hour. That's the one statistic we don't really have, is how many acres we can cover per hour of like planting or cultivation. Tillage, and it always varies depending on what tractor you have behind it, because this is a lot more horsepower than our 450s. The 450s kind of struggle with the 2720s from time to time. They, you know, they're averaging around like 8 miles an hour, where this thing would probably be pulling it at, I don't know, 11, 12 or something. Pretty good. It's not a very hilly field, so you don't see it flex as much. As, maybe the planter would. I always really like the design of this disc when it's all folded up. It looks really cool. Did two headlamp pass. That's nice. So if you guys watch the raise and lower, you'd see that the whole unit and that this front arm moves too with the hitch. It's a little bit off because the animation's a little bit off because we're on the server, but. Big kid is just playing with this huge disc. So I think we're going to go ahead and plant alfalfa here again, just because we got such a great profit margin with alfalfa. We pretty much put down no nutrients in this field, and all we did was, you know, it costs really nothing to rent the baler and the merger and a telehandler. You know, it's probably probably like close to $3,000 of rental fees to merge and collect all of our bales and load it on the trailers. So. The cost of production on this field is really, really low. So, if we had two of these large discs going, tillage would get done very, very quick. I'm glad we're just able to cultivate in all those nutrients before we go ahead and plant. So far, like, I'm very pleased with how everything's going on the server. It's like we're kind of running a real little virtual business here. We're all putting in, you know, our fair share of work and hours. Just minor mistakes here and there, but nothing too major. So we're controlling our cost of production. One thing I'd like to see in FS15 is that damage control mod, so you have to do maintenance on your machines. Because right now, it has the cost, operating cost of machines, you know, per day. But it'd be a little bit nice if someone slams in like a grain cart into the semi if you had to go with your repair vehicle, your service vehicle, and repair it, or you know, your disc is gonna need repair after so many hours of using it and stuff like that. Or like your planter, if you use it for, you know, 24 hours, it starts getting, you know, wear and tear after so many hours of usage. I think that'd be cool. So the nice thing is, with this being rented, is we don't have to really wash it when we return it. We get dinged like $200 for not washing it, but who really cares? It costs us like $15,000 to rent this whole tractor and disc for one day, so who cares about $200 no wash fee? So this is by far the best. I mean, between this and the TigerMate 200, I think this one actually has just a tad bit more detail into the framework. But overall, I think the TigerMate, just the design of the cultivator, warranted more detail. Just because it had a lot more complex raise and lower design than this. This raise and lower system is pretty basic as compared to the TigerMate, but overall this actually has a little bit higher quality detail, say like in cylinders, inside the frame. It's got cotton pins, it's got, if you look in the frame, it's got these bulges in the frame for where your bolts go in. I made new discs for this. They actually have like a cutting edge on them. And they look really nice. Seem to be looking really nice in the field. Cylinders have hose. Well, it's all kind of dirty now. But. And then I finally actually scripted it correctly. I have the hitch that raises and lowers with the implement. Where my 2720 doesn't do that, and my TigerMate doesn't do that, but I will go back and fix that. And I also plan on making that into a 60-foot TigerMate too, so I have a 30-foot and a 60-foot. I really wish there was a third train, or that Decker incorporated like soil compaction into his soil mod, because I would like to script this as a plow, and I'd like to have a cultivator for cultivator texture, but I'd like to have a separate thing for like a chisel plow that would remove compaction just because of the deep shank rippers. And obviously if you were to do chisel plow, it'd add more nutrients than your plow texture, or, you know, it'd be like a disc. I don't know. I think that would be something that I saw on his latest soil mod. He incorporated a new cultivator type that allows you to use a toolbar for mechanical weed removal. But I imagine that he could incorporate a compaction line in a script with like a plugin, which would be used with his wheel lane mod, because the wheel lane, maybe he could make like a separate painted layer, I don't know, but I think it would be possible to do, and I think it would be a great feature to have, really. And it would go by the mass of your machine in GE. You know, if you have 25-ton machine versus a 14-ton machine. And, you know, just work it back like the soil moisture. Soil moisture slowly goes up or down, or every time you chisel plow it, the soil compaction goes back to zero. More compaction, the less benefit the moisture has, or the lower yield you have. I just think it's possible, and I think it would be a great thing to try to accomplish. He has it so cover crops, so if you disc in cover crops, kind of like we are, you get a little spike in nutrients after like three growth stages or two growth stages or something like that. Which is nice, because I have my alfalfa that grows about two growth stages quicker than, say, corn or soybean or the rest of the crop, so it grows at the same rate of, I think it's one stage longer than grass. Anyways, you can see the frame flex a little bit over here. So this farm on the hill, it's all viable, so you can, and it's a fully functioning dairy farm with all the feed triggers and manure, liquid manure and straw and stuff like that. It has a manual milk trigger too, if you want to use a milk tank and drive it over to the dairy for a little bit more money. I think it has like a price multiplier of like 1.2 if you were to drive it over. All the beef farms are viable, grain farms you need to purchase, all the bin storages you need to purchase, and now they have separate, they're all kind of off the cloud now. Yeah, I was going to show you guys last time, but for whatever reason it wasn't really working, so. Thank you. So you can see over here that there's nothing showing up. It's all zeros on this display. I don't know if you guys can see that, but everything is 000. If we come over to this grain complex, it's all of our crops. For whatever reason, this HUD, in GE it's soybean and oat, but in the game it reverts back to barley and wheat, so I'm not really sure. Whatever that is. So that's the nice thing about this new farm silo is it's kind of like a condensed universal process kit. So pretty happy with that. And then this guy. So that's what I was trying to talk to you about earlier. Having silos that are basically off the cloud, and so when you buy a new silo complex, all the grain you put in there stays there and you can't unload it from, say, like another trigger, because it's all part of an individual unit. And I mean, it will show in the PDA like your total amount of grain, but you'll only be able to pull whatever grain out of the bin that you put into it. So that's really cool. And they all have obviously capacities. Like that's probably like a, I'm not sure if it's a 100 or 120 bushel grain complex. Those little bins are 30,000 bushels. So there is a capacity there, and I think it warns you when you're getting close. I mean, you can just look at all the levels and say like what percentage I'm at. So that was one thing I was really glad to see. I just like, all of a sudden he shows up with that. So that was really cool to get a hold of that. Then all I have to do is get levels on my fertilizer tank storage. So then we have to run down to the CPS with the truck and load up. You know, say give us like uh, 50 or 100,000 liter storage there at the farm of liquid fertilizer. And once you run out of that, you have to go back to the CPS and fill up and replenish your farm supply. Getting any flexing going on? Should get some nice flexing right here. Man, like 12,100, a little over that subscribers, so it's pretty cool. Glad you guys are enjoying the videos. Oh shit. Run button. Cannot wait to do corn on those two big fields over there. I think we're gonna try to do a really nice, nicely done planting video. I wanna have Jake set up his eye action so he can record, and then we can kinda like video edit the two video recordings together. So you get a different perspective. The two planters going. I really want to figure out how to do that, how to kind of like mesh two videos together so we get a little bit different perspective. One bigger. To take our plow over here, really, and fix some of these areas, but the fold. This thing looks so good folded up. So then the question is, where do we go to next? 26, 27, 28, 29, 34. Let's buzz on down to Actually, we need to do 29, don't we? Yeah. Time to doze over some old corn. So, that large grain complex over there is 250,000 bushel, courtesy of Abel Farms. Then we have the big beef farm up there, the modern beef farm, with the beef sheds I built. Have two of those, and then have some feed bunkers and some nice fencing over there. And the liquid lagoon, some big open-up bale shed. So really like that farm over there. These fields over here, it's in between 8 and 9 and 16 over here, it's a little bit plain. So I think I could actually dress it up with a little bit of trees and bushes. You know, nothing too extreme, but it's a little bit bare. Maybe put in some old fence work, like it used to be, like old pasture or something like that. So this is basically like a neighbor's old field that he never got harvested, and basically he just said screw it to farming, and now we're leasing it from him. We're putting a lot of money and nutrients into it. I keep saying that FarmSim should be kind of like a massive multiplayer, like online game, where we each have our own, we start out with our own like plot of land, and then you know, everything that someone does influences everyone's gameplay. Like if someone unloads like 8,000 bushels of, or like 800,000 bushels of a corn, you know, it affects the price of the commodity, the price of corn. And you know, you can buy land from other people, you can buy old equipment, you can hire people to come work your fields, you can do like partnerships, like this guy's got all the equipment, he's got the land, so we'll do a partnership, or you can do contracting. I think FarmSim should really go the direction of a multi-MMO style game, an MMO sandbox style game, kind of like kind of like a EVE Online kind of system, because, and then all the mods, you know, you could, all the mods would be like go through through Giants. You'd only be able to download and use it if it's like part of the Giants like MMO server. That way you could like submit a mod and then you don't have to worry about anyone like taking it or using it, and they can't like download it and edit it and re-upload it. So I think that's really what it would pretty much not only enhance the gameplay, like it'd be so much better of a gameplay. It'd be more realistic because, you know, the whole community could actually like play together and stuff like that. Yeah, it'd just be a lot more dynamic. Anyways, I really think they should look into that because I think that would ensure the success. And the company that does it first will obviously be at the, they'll capture pretty much probably the entire market share with that. But that's definitely the way it should go. Because right now, even on multiplayer, it's pretty boring. There's no one else on the map playing. Maps are small. It's, I don't know. It's just so basic and primitive. If I were to design a game, that's the route I would take because it makes the most sense to me. To have it a MMO style sandbox game, because those are the most successful games ever in the gaming industry. Apparently we don't own this little section of field. Interesting. Be conflicting with field 35. I mean, the game is pretty fun and pretty addicting the way it is now, but there's literally like so much potential. Like, I would say this game right now is probably less than 5% of the game it could be if they were to really pour some passion into it. There's just so much potential that isn't being, you know, even thought of right now or being taken seriously. It's, you know, little band-aid improvements, little band-aid patch fixes just to from where I first started, when I first started playing like a farming simulator, was I think it was just called Sim Farm. Yeah, I think it was Sim Farm. It was back in, I remember the day actually. It was like 2000 or 2001. I came home from school, and my mom, there's the guy, he was a computer guy that went to our church, and he was at our house. So I'm like, what is this guy? His name is Jeff. So I was like, what is Jeff doing here? Anyways, I just got off the, me and my sister got off the bus and we were walking home, and all of a sudden I see into my dad's office, they're setting up a computer, and I'm like, huh, we're getting your computer. It's like, we only have these things at school. Anyways, it was like a $2,100 computer at the time, and today's standards was a piece of shit, but back then it was really cool, and it was like the most addicting thing I've ever experienced. I mean, I've never done drugs, so I don't know how that compares, but then that's when I started getting into computer games and stuff. And, Sim Farm was one of the, I think one of the first games I installed on the computer, and it was really fun. And then I think the next farming game I got was like a John Deere farmer or something like that. And I don't know, I never really got into that, but I did enjoy Sim Farm. And then probably like eight or so years went by, and I was kind of like interested in it again. And then I came up about like a year after FS13 was released, I found that and started playing that. And then at the same time I found Euro Truck Simulator 2, and I played that for about 10 minutes and I about fell asleep. So pretty much stuck with Farm Sim. And then was pretty displeased with how it was European. Everything was European. All these European warning signs and stuff. And then so began the long journey that is long from finished, of learning how to edit. And then eventually I built up the courage to learn how to mod, that is, actually model new content, to learn how to use modeling programs to edit existing mods. But just recently learned how to actually mod, not just edit like where everyone starts. And, you know, I really like maps too, but in 13 there's a lot of great maps out there. There was a lot of great maps where I really liked some aspects of it, that disliked this aspect or it was missing this aspect, so that kind of like prompted me to make my own map. And here we are, just about as close to being finished with this as I'll probably ever be, as I turn my sights on making a new map based on the area where I grew up. This is kind of funny how the timeline of these things. Yeah, and, it's just kind of interesting to watch as I improve at modeling and scripting and texturing and map making, how basically my channel grows and page grows, and how many people you know, message me and thank me for inspiring them to learn to mod and model, and thank me for tutorials. And, it's really great. I have to turn off my messages because I just get so many, it's overwhelming really. And that's good. I'm glad you guys are all enjoying the videos and enjoying seeing me progress, and hopefully you are too. And those that have pulled the trigger and bit the bullet, so to speak, learn themselves, I'm sure you're finally experiencing what I've been talking about this whole time. Is the only way you really get that sense of accomplishment, that feeling of accomplishment, is by achieving, you know, setting a goal and then achieving it. And, you know, for example, learning Blender, it's not easy. It's not an easy software to learn, but once you do learn it, once you put in the time up front and you put in the hard work, it, you know, it becomes easier and easier, and you learn more and more, and the more mistakes you learn, the more efficient you get by progressing, because you make less and less mistakes. And it becomes really rewarding, and it's something you really can't understand or comprehend until you do it. It's kind of like someone that, studying for an exam, you put in 100 hours of studying for this exam and then you just knock out of the park. You know, the one person that maybe studied for 10 hours and failed, like, they feel like total shit, and they really should, because they didn't do their due diligence. And, you know, unfortunately, that person that failed probably will come up with some kind of excuse, or the teacher sucks at teaching, or they didn't motivate me. No, it's all about self-intrinsic motivation, and those that are, you know, taking the time like myself and now others are doing to really, really push themselves. They understand that reward, that sense of accomplishment. Like I said, you can't get that from a click of a mouse or downloading a link. So talent is not bought nor downloaded. It is earned through hard work and many hours, and only achieved through many, many failures. So whatever your goal is you want to accomplish, maybe you want to get better at just editing existing mods to be more American. Like, I have a tutorial on how to do that. Maybe you just want to learn to texture better. Maybe you want to learn to model. Maybe you want to make better, you know, less boxy, more, you know, bevelish looking frame. I don't know. Whatever your goal is, like, you need to stay diligent to it, and you need to do a thorough search before you ask others for help. Because those that have already done, like myself, I know what's available because I've done the thorough process of search and destroy myself. I mean, there's no tutorials available when I was learning. It's every question that I've literally been asked has been asked hundreds of times before, and it's been answered. So the information is readily available and exists today. It's the same information available that I used to learn. And people are looking for videos for this, videos for that, and I understand, I get that. You wanna be efficient, you wanna reduce the learning curve, it makes sense, I'm all about that. But the thing is, you need to do due diligence on your end first. You need to put in the time, because a lot of the questions I'm asked on a daily basis, I completely ignore, because I know that individual spent zero time, not even a simple Google search. You know, if they were to spend some time on AEM, AEM has a database of threats that you can use a search function and find whatever it is you're looking for. And FSUK has an even larger database of information that you could pull on. And this is where I go to whenever I have a question. I go right there. There's a Giants Developer Network. I don't really recommend that, because A lot of the stuff they post there isn't it's kind of information they give on the answers to the question is very vague and not very helpful. So you can't even go back and look at old threads, questions people were asking, and see how others explain the solution. Giants Development, like, you really can't do that, because the answers to the problem, the solutions aren't very specific. But and there's a lot of videos not related to FarmSim, but there's so many videos on YouTube of how to learn the basics. And basically, just spend a weekend and just, like, watch the videos. I mean, spend a couple hours, learn the basics, go in and fart around with it, learn it. Script editing, it's really basic. Just download a bunch of mods, look at the XML, then look at the mod in GE and look at the notes it's referencing and put the dots together, and it's really not that difficult. But it does take time, and it does take patience, and it does take diligence. And you have to have a thick skin, because if you're one of those people that gets all bent out of shape quickly because you're so used to instant gratification and you're so used to getting your way, you know, you're probably going to have an extremely difficult time to learn the process. That's my little warning. Warning, it's not easy. This is a nice little field. Oh, that little corner of that field is kind of bothering me, but it is a odd-shaped. How many sides is this? This is five-sided. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah. Need to make new fenders, redo the hood, make a more detailed interior. So. This is actually a pretty old model at this point. I was building this when I was building my DB120, and looking at the kind of craftsmanship I'm doing now on these mods, it's starting to go back and redo some of my old mods. I redid my Kinsey 1500, built this disc. I'm gonna go back and redo the 2720, going back right now, currently redoing the DB planters. I plan on having my 24, 36, and 48 row, so I'll make new ridge markers for DB90, and I'm going back and just putting more detail to the frame, replacing the bolts and stuff like that from the cylinders from like stuff like this, and making a 700 series Challenger. Need to finish up my Land Roller too, because now we're getting pretty dang close to fast approaching planting season. I'd say probably another week and a half, maybe 2 weeks, the boys will have all the tillage done and we'll be looking at planting. So that gives me probably, you know, 2 to 3 weeks worth of modeling time to finish up that Land Roller and script it. So I think that will be plenty. It's already about halfway finished. Just hard to find pictures of how everything connects and unfolds. And, whatever. It's going to be a 45-foot three-section roller. Should be pretty fun to fly around the field with. Kind of fix the folding animation on the Oxbow. When you first buy it, it's kind of funky until you press X and stuff like that, but that has to do with the animation LUA script that I'm using on it, but we'll figure that out eventually. Might do a new burn on that, because the burns that I'm doing now, I'm using like Blender 2.76B or something like that. For whatever reason, the improvements they made, I was using like Blender 2.6, 2.72, I don't know what I was using before, but it was about 2 months, 2.5 months ago, and now when I went to do new burns, my burns using the same settings, use same hex color, same world ambient factor, they were coming out a lot more pale, the green wasn't as rich. Vibrant, and so whatever they did, they changed their lighting settings for Blender Render when I'm doing my diffuse burn. So, but my god, they come out so much cleaner and more crisp than they were in the previous version. So, you know, a lot of the things I did before, they were good, but now they're gonna just come out a lot better when I go back and reburn them. And, pretty excited about that. So. Because that's one thing about the whole modeling process is your model might look very like great, but it's only as good as the textures you can burn on that model. So if you suck ass at baking textures, your model's gonna look like shit, regardless of how accurate the modeling is. And you know, we do this. It's the same aspect in dentistry too. When we're looking at like a restorative case, the morphology of your restoration might look really great. Like it's biomimetic; it looks exactly like the real thing. But if your shading and your translucencies are off, and you have metamerism going on with the lighting in your office, where the lights look, the shades and the translucency looks off in a different lighting setting, it will look completely different. So that's the thing, like, it's all about texturing. If your texturing is off and doesn't look great, or it's pixelated or fuzzy, or your margins are off, if you have bleeding, it really, really turns a great looking model into less than, you know, it just does not do it justice. And learning to texture and texture well is definitely took me the longest time. It's definitely a huge trial and error process. There's a whole lot of information out there. There's a lot of conflicting information. There's a lot of information that is irrelevant. There's a lot of information that doesn't even apply. You know, people throw around the term ambient occlusion. I don't use ambient occlusion to burn my textures. I use ambient occlusion for my world lighting, but I don't actually burn an ambient occlusion diffuse map, because it's not the proper way to do it, and it's not how Blender is designed to texture. It's not designed to texture in ambient occlusion. It uses the ambient occlusion of the world lighting to burn the diffuse texture into the map. So that's what I learned after reading and searching, because everyone throws around the term an AO texture, and basically what they really mean is you have a diffuse texture that's burnt with ambient occlusion lighting, which will reflect like a sun on your model, but you're not actually burning an AO texture, because it turns out shit. So that's just a lack of a sound and firm understanding of the texturing process. And that's something you only really learn if you put in the time and read manuals and read what the actual definition is and what the expected outcome is. If you don't know what a setting is designed to do, and you know, how can you predict a result if you don't know what you're applying is going to do, or like what you're trying to do, what you're using is actually supposed to be used for. You know, if you're trying to use a hammer to screw in a screw, you're probably not going to be very successful. So it's really, you know, that's what makes Blender so complicated, is there's a tool for a very specific function, and depending on what you're trying to achieve, you know there's a tool for this, tool for that. And so what process you use, or what combination of processes, or in what order you use each process is crucial to what you're trying to achieve, and you only learn that through studying, being a student of the program. And it's not easy. You just can't click this, go on YouTube for 10 minutes and figure it out. It's not that simple, and it takes a process of learning, and it's a process of learning and practicing to get to a mastery level. Well, not even a mastery level, but to a level of competence. Like, once you're competent and you have a firm fundamental knowledge and foundation, then you can really dive into more you know, set your sights onto the mastery aspect. That doesn't. I'm still at the point where I'm getting a fundamental firm foundation of knowledge. Nowhere near the point of knowing what everything is, what Blender can really achieve. So I imagine it's going to take anywhere from, or probably take another year and a half, really, of studying to really get to the point where I've truly, truly understand the software and its abilities and what I can do. And so just to give you an idea, I've been working with it for about a year and a half now. So I would say a 3-year minimum to get to the level of black belt, black belt master. No, but it definitely is going to take probably for the above average person, the above average person with a learning ability. If you can learn quickly, I would say it'll take you probably 3 years of rigorous studying and being a student of the software to actually be extremely proficient at it. But just to get around and do basic things like import a model, apply a texture, and take pieces and parts off and separate stuff, and, you know, that's really basic. I could do a tutorial of that in 30 minutes. That is very easy to teach someone because it's a very low level of skill required. It's a very low level of knowledge. You really need to know nothing about Blender or the modifiers or anything like that to actually use it. All you need to know is a few short keyboard hotkeys, and that's it. You don't even need to know how textures and applying textures work. All you have to do is do what I did, and it's done. Like, you don't even need to understand why I'm doing what I'm doing. You just need to know that it works for something that simple. So, and I think that's what a lot of people are looking for, and there's only, you know, there's not very many people that are looking to actually, like, invest a great deal of time to really become more than just proficient. Like, they have personal intrinsic motivation. They want to make really great high quality models. They want to get great textures. They want to, you know, and so they're gonna work at it. They're gonna keep working at it until they get to where they feel satisfied, and then they're gonna set another goal and then keep working at that. It's, you know, it's just their mentality of a really high achieving person. But there's a lot of things that I figured out just by trial and error, because it's not available. You can't Google it. There's no one going to tell you, here's the answer. It's kind of like a get-rich-quick book. No one's going to tell you how to make money. They'll tell you the characteristics and traits and attributes that will increase your odds of being successful, but they're not going to tell you how to make money because no one knows. If everyone knew how to make money, you know, everyone would be rich. So it's definitely all about character traits. And modeling is no different. It's all about figuring out what it is that you're trying to achieve. Like, when I start making my Blender tutorials, the first question I'm going to ask you guys is, why do you want to learn? Like, what is your main reason for wanting to learn how to model? Why are you trying to learn to use Blender? Why are you trying to learn the XML? Why are you trying to do whatever it is? And once you figure out that answer, then you can progress. But if you don't even know the answer to that question, you're already sunk. You're already dead in the water before you start. The reason why I say you're dead in the water is because it requires a lot of motivation to go through the whole process. I mean, look at Raphael, or look at me, or, you know, you start a model, you pour 40, 60 hours into it, then you get burnt out. And then it just sits there in your computer and you don't touch it for 4 months. So when you're starting to, like, learn a new topic, it's extremely exhausting. It's difficult, it's hard, it takes a lot of time. And so you need to have to make sure you have the proper motivations there so you don't get burnt out and quit. So that's the first question I'm going to ask, is why do you want to do this? What are you looking to achieve? And that's really going to set the tone to how successful you will be at learning the modding and modeling process. And then another thing is, like, I hear it all the time, like, I don't have time. I wish I could, but I don't have time. The question you need to ask yourself is, are you making an excuse because you don't want to, you know it's hard and you don't want to work hard? Or how much time do you think it really is going to take? How much time do you think you can afford to spend in an evening or a week? I guarantee instead of sitting down and watching Dancing with the Stars or Survivor or some other retarded TV show, you can put that time aside to reading, or you can put that time aside to watching a tutorial video, or you can spend that extra hour reading the Blender menu. There's like, you have the time because I have the time, and I know my schedule is busier than yours. I guarantee it. Without question. And if I can find the time, you most certainly can find the time. The time is there, it's just how do you prioritize and how do you time management? Guarantee if you look at your day, you reflect back on your day, yeah, you'll find probably 4 or 5 hours that you just wasted doing nothing. Like, the time is already there. You just need to prioritize it. So those are the two biggest hurdles that you really need to confront yourself with, and you need to, you know, quit pointing the finger, making up excuses, and you need to really, really explain to yourself and convince yourself that it's just an excuse. And there's really no need for that. If it's really truly something you want to do, you'll make it happen. I feel like I've been disking this little field forever. But wouldn't that be great, going back to the MMO style, like, you can have other players driving up and down this road with their machines or their trucks, and, you know, this guy's working this field across the road, there's another guy working this field, or this guy, you know, how sweet would that be? Are you driving down the road and people are in the midst of harvest, and it would be great because the whole season would progress, you know, the same time for everyone, so everyone's doing the harvesting at the same time, everyone's planting at, you know, the same time, everyone's spraying at the same time. So I think that would be insanely cool to have something like that. Or you could have different counties, or like, I don't know, I think it would be really, really cool to have something like that. I think just about everyone would agree with me on that. That is a good idea. You know, because the way it is right now, the community is so divided. It's divided between the haves and the have-nots. The motivated and the unmotivated, the talented and the untalented, the moochers and the creators. That's what Farm Sim is today, and it's not going to change because the way the game is set up, it's set up where it relies on users to produce and release new, authentic, original, user-generated content. And, you know, that requires a tremendous amount of time. And then those that do release content, they get shit on their work. It's criticized, blah, 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 whatever you want to say. Anyways, if you were to go with an MMO where someone makes and puts, you know, 100, 2 hours into a mod, it goes to Giants. Giants uploads it to the server, and no one can touch it after that. That would solve everything. And by being an MMO, it would actually be a community at that point, because you would be playing in game with everyone else. You don't even know who they are, you know. And that would, I mean, I can't see any negative downside to what I'm suggesting. All the current problems would not exist under that scenario. And there would probably be a lot more high quality content for everyone at that point, because it would eliminate all the problems associated with people releasing their hard-earned work. It would eliminate the sense of entitlement. It would eliminate hack job artists. They would eliminate people that, for example, turn a John Deere purple. You know, like, it completely eliminates those idiots' ability to screw people over. And I really think Giants should take it serious, because, you know, in my 2-year tenure of playing Farm Sim, I watched the community just completely get destroyed. And it didn't start there. It was slowly declining since FS 09. And it's only going to continue to decline. And basically, I really strongly suggest they look into that. If, you know, it's not going to bankrupt their company, their company's not going to suffer, but I mean, you know, their customers are going to be less and less happy every year, unless Giants continues to pump out a lot of DLCs, which I think they probably will, because they make a lot of money by doing that. If people want new mods, and they want nice mods, they're accustomed to people releasing nice quality mods. Not anymore. Now you can obviously, they're all pretty much having temper tantrums about it. But it's going to be on Giants if they don't do something where they protect original user generated content. It's going to be on them to supply their paying customers with quality DLCs. And then eventually people will be really upset that they have to purchase all these add-ons just to have a quality game. I don't know. And then you have other companies that see all the potential of all this market share that they can capture, because they're looking at what the players, their consumer, the complaints. They are looking at that and they're addressing that, and they're going to capture a tremendous amount of market share. And basically that's what happens in business. If your competitor takes advantage of there's an opportunity in the market, and you have your cash cow product, and then your competitor addresses this whole new section of the market share, or you're ignoring your customer complaints, and then all of a sudden this new company addresses those issues, they're going to capture a significant amount of your market share, and all of a sudden your cash cow product is no longer a cash cow. You're going to have to put in a tremendous amount of resources to capture back that market share, instead of a little bit of resources to maintain it. So, I mean, I don't really care. I have no financial ties to Giants, so, I mean, but I do enjoy the game, and I'd hate to see, you know, a game suffer because, but whatever. It is what it is. It's pretty black and white. It's out in the open. It's no secret, but only time will tell if they act on it. So I feel 34 did take quite a bit of time, even with this big disc. But anyways, I'm probably going to end the video here and then start working on 29. So thanks for watching.